Hello, my name is Zap Mamane, and this is my Haunted Halloween 85 audition for AGDQ 2019. Haunted Halloween 85 is an NES classic console cartridge game created by Retrotainment just about 2 or 3 years ago, and it was interesting to have seen them when I was at PAX. I'm like, hey, I'm an old school gamer, I'm a speedrunner, let me take a look at this. This looks like a very fun platforming game, and lo and behold, it was amazing. I proceeded to beat the game in my first sitting right in front of the developers, and they were quite impressed. I was compelled to buy not only one, but a second cartridge for my friend that very moment. And so I proceeded to speedrun the game right away, actually. I didn't do it live. My son was going to be born in less than a month, so I didn't really spend a whole lot of time on it. But now that he's 3 years old, I feel I have a little bit more time than I used to be able to put towards something like this. So as far as what I'm doing, it's level one is pretty straightforward. There's not a whole lot you're doing except jumping at very specific intervals to not slow yourself down at all possible. You can pretty much run straight forward the entire level without missing a beat. And it's pretty easy once you get to the boss too, because the boss is, it stands still, it doesn't do anything besides throw things at you, and your punch is pretty omnipotent sometimes, where when an enemy walks into your fist, it does full damage. So you just let the enemies walk into your fist, beat up the boss, and you move right on to the next stage. Stage 2 is a little bit trickier. It incorporates some different hazards. It incorporates a new enemy, the bat, or the crow. Sorry, I believe actually it's a crow. The crow can be a bit annoying because against dark and pure black backgrounds, all you can see is his eyeballs. Makes it for a little interesting. I actually like that touch. That was a very nifty little touch that they added, where the enemy is nearly invisible against the night sky. But so far so good. I have a pretty solid run. This is my favorite part. It's just like 10 seconds of walking through a pasture, an empty field. But then you get to the new enemy, the pumpkin. According to the manual, pumpkins are invincible. There is no way to harm them, so all you have to do is avoid them. They jump when you jump, but their jump is not equal to your jump. So if you time your jumps right, you can go over or under them. I take a couple of unfortunate hits there. It can be a little tricky trying to tap the jump button very precisely. You modulate your movements so that you avoid them. When you enter the cave is probably one of my favorite tunes in the entire game. I actually got to talk to the audio creator when I was at PAX, and we had a great conversation about how tricky it was to work with the Nintendo sound, and he thought it was a lot of fun trying to work with limited hardware to try to get the sounds that you want. The second boss is pretty simple. He jumps around a couple of times, giant Sasquatch. You put a couple of well-placed punches into his stomach and his behind, and he's got nothing. Stage 3, you make it to the mall. The mall it's got one of the best tunes in the entire game as well. It's really catchy. My wife and I actually were humming this song for weeks after I started playing this game back when we got it. Definitely one of our favorites. So what I'm doing here is second punch in the air, it does a whopping 4 damage. So if you can time your second punch to hit the enemies that have full health, like the zombies who have 4 health, if you land it just right and put your entire body weight into it. And what I mean by that is your sprite is very close to their sprite. When the punch hits, it will do 4 damage and one-shot them. So you'll notice sometimes the zombie's going down in one hit. That's what I'm doing. I'm landing my second air punch just right as I'm landing my character. So I slide my body into them with my fist, dealing those 4 damage while not losing momentum. It's a very important technique in this game, is doing your best to not lose momentum, because in a platformer, we all know, if you're not moving, you're losing frames, and that is just not acceptable in a speedrun. So making it through them all, I love the different shoutouts to all the 1985 different movies and all the all the things that they do for that is pretty nifty. Boss number three, the mall. It is one of the most annoying bosses in this entire game. It probably, to me, is the most annoying boss. It's a bunch of little birds that come flying at you in seemingly random patterns, and they do not stop. They just keep moving. And if you can get them sequentially, just keep nailing them one at a time, you have to take out like 15 of them before the round is over. So the faster you can do that, obviously, the faster the giant crow will spawn, and then you can finish the boss off. Now the cornfield, this is where the difficulty really ramps up. There are tons of obstacles. You're actually going to be entering certain areas that go vertical instead of horizontal. That's an interesting touch, like this silo, for instance. My silo climb was pretty nifty in this run. I have to say, probably the best silo run I've ever had, ascending and on the descending as well. Dodging these ghosts is definitely a lot harder than it looks. As you can see, I take out both of those zombies with the second punch as I slide into them. Unfortunately, when I made that jump there, I mistimed and the pumpkin jumped a little bit awkwardly. I wasn't expecting the way it was jumping, and I landed right into it. That second pumpkin was definitely what should have happened last time. So unfortunately, I had a death there, but in a marathon, I mean, you take the punches and you roll with them. Again, I just took another hit when I wasn't expecting. What you want to do is you want to have full life going into this next area, into the barn. Because you're going to be taking a lot of damage boosting, and there's not going to be a lot of health refills, at least very accessible ones. So I take a hit prior to entering the barn, and so I want to fill up. So unfortunately, I have to take a little sidetrack to fill up my health. These different rooms each are pretty unique. I actually like the level design in this game is quite amazing as far as the uniqueness of it. It starts out really simple, like, hey, you're jumping on a barrel and you're, you know, advancing through a trash barrel. Well, it gets quite technical once you get past stage three. There are a lot of really technical jumps. I think some of them might even be frame perfect and pixel perfect jumps. I will not be performing any of those because it's not really necessary. I think if you can pull off the pixel perfect jump in stage five, you can maybe save a second or two, but definitely not worth it in a marathon. Now, the reason I jumped down into that pit is because I only had one or two hits left, and I was likely taking at least one or two points of damage during this boss fight. So I wanted to refill my health as soon as I hit the checkpoint. And that way, when I was fighting the boss, I didn't die during the boss, losing a lot of time. Stage 5 is definitely one of the hardest stages to perform completely without air. There are so many little tricks, little jumps that are very precise. Like the momentum that you have, the spawns. I haven't actually talked about spawns. Spawns in this game, the game can only handle about 6 sprites at any one time. So if you can do it right, and that includes power-ups, the health pickups and the life pickups. So if you can do it right by not killing certain enemies, then you can cause enemies that you're supposedly going to be meeting up with to not spawn. So you'll be seeing that in a moment here. I'm going to take out these ghosts, and then I'm going to take out one ghost, and I'm going to take a damage there. So now that there are so many things following me, the ghosts right here won't spawn until I'm mid-jump. Neither actually will the health pickup. So that's the noise you heard. I'm going to take an intentional death here because this next area is a little tricky to do without taking any damage. And I knew I was only at one health. So I wanted to refresh my health by taking a death at the beginning of the checkpoint. Unfortunately, I missed this cycle right here, but it actually isn't too bad. You only lose about a second or two. But the game just throws so many enemies at you. Knowing exactly where they are is very important, which is true for most of any platformers, namely like Ninja Gaiden. Oh my goodness, don't get me started on that game. That's a crazy speedrun. But anyway, the sewer is not too bad. It's just a bunch of ghosts, so nothing is going to be jumping out at you at like those zombie dogs, which thankfully only have one hit, but you can avoid most of them. Actually, I think I avoid all but one, not counting this. The werewolf boss. So, the werewolf boss, when he spawns, if you run up to him, you can get a couple of hits in. He's invincible while he's chasing you. But if you wait about, I don't know, what, 6-7 seconds, he will then start howling, and while he's howling, he is vulnerable. And he has about, I think he has four, as you see him like groaning up and down and howling at the moon, that's because I did enough damage to put him into the next phase. Each phase, the boss moves a little bit faster. And so with a point where he's almost as fast as you are. But I actually made pretty short work of that werewolf. He's often very tough. So here at the final stage, you're in the graveyard, and you'll be moving into some crypts, and then on your way to fight the final boss, which is the farmer. This stage is, it pulls out all the stops. It tries its best to make sure that you don't make it to the end. Especially when you're speedrunning, there's just so many things that you make one mistake and it can sometimes spell your doom. Fortunately, I have enough health that, and by enough, I mean I have one hit right now, one extra hit. I can tank a couple of hits here and I can perform the first real glitch that we'll be utilizing, and that is clipping through the ceiling. If you clip through the ceiling, then you don't have to worry about any of the monsters, the zombies and the ghosts that are spawning through this tight corridor in this cave, and the spikes in the ceiling just completely takes them out of the picture, and you can just waltz right over them and still make it to the end of the area. So I'm going to take a death here to fill up my health, because I'm going to need a couple of damage boosts before getting to the final boss. I shouldn't need any health at the final boss, because if you do it right, you don't take any damage at all. And in fact, you'll actually kill him before he attacks you, because there is a clip we'll be doing. Just like going through the ceiling in that cave, we're going to be going through the roots. And if you time it just right, it'll zip you right up to him. And then you can beat down on the farmer before he has a chance to move. And that is the end of the run. I hope you enjoyed it. And that is Haunted Halloween 1985. Fun fact, this is based out of Johnstown, Pennsylvania, and that happens to be where my mom was born. And her parents went through the flood of Johnstown, and so there's a lot of history that is involved with this game. And my mom just recently went through cancer, so this game means a lot to me, and I would really look forward to, if you would have me to run this game. I feel like I could do it justice, and I think it would be a great fit. I'm not sure, and I don't think it's been run in a GDQ at all in the past. I don't think very many people even know about it. It'd be interesting to see this game get a little bit of spotlight, and the developers are working on more titles too. So thank you very much, and I appreciate you watching and for considering Haunted Halloween 1985. Thank you very much.